please bow our head for prayers? We are here, Lord, to thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship you in your holy name. We are all here to say thank you for your wonderful blessing and for being with our family and friends and for blessing us this week. In your holy name, amen. You may be seated. I am so happy to be here. Well, not exactly right here, but in the house of the Lord. My English is not so good, but I hope you can understand that I want to tell you, welcome everyone. And if you are friends that coming to visit us for the first time today, or you are members, or you're watching us online, we want to tell you that we are so happy to be here in the house of the Lord, and please come back and do it again. In Spanish church, we have a custom that in this time, the welcome time, we get up and we shake hands and we hug and while we are sing a song. And today, maybe we will not sing that song because you don't know it, but we still can take maybe 1 or 2 minutes to the people in front of us, or in the back, or in the right, on the left. Just smile, hug, shake the hands, telling happy Sabbath and welcome. So at the same time, we want to tell you welcome everyone to South Lancaster Church. And by the music place, we can start to greet each other. Thank you so much, and I see you next time, or next Saturday.
Happy Sabbath, Church. The call to worship is found in Psalms 100. If you will turn to your Bibles, please. I will ask the congregation to read responsibly with me. I will be reading verse 1, and you will be reading verse 2. I will be reading verse 3, and you will be reading verse 4. And then we will all read verse 5 together. Shout triumphantly to the Lord, all the earth. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are his people, the sheep of his pasture. For the Lord is good, and his love is eternal. His faithfulness endures through all generations.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath, church. Ooh, I like how that sounds. It's springtime, and God is good. And we're here this weekend. It's the world here in the United States is celebrating Memorial Day. Memorial Day. And it's a time when we reflect on sacrifices that people have made. But the ultimate sacrifice is the one that Jesus made on Calvary. He created us and he died for us. And this is my Father's world. Hymn number 92, This Is My Father's World. We'll also be singing hymn number 44 right after. We give thanks to you, O God, for making us.
This is my listening ears. Oh.
Can you say amen? Thank you to the Hunt family. Thank you to Christian Imperio. Christian, I do this every once in a while. Can you turn around? We get to look at his back and enjoy his music almost every Sabbath. How about you give him a smile back and say thanks?
Thank you, Christian.
Nothing personal, Heather or Tom, but there are days or Sabbaths when I might not remember all of what you share with us, but I do take some of their music with me throughout the day and the week ahead. And Larry Katie as well, thank you for everything you do musically and spiritually for us. It's time for our offering, and it's Memorial Day weekend. It is a Memorial Day, is it not? It's Sabbath, but it's Memorial Day weekend. And so just a short personal testimony from me. I come from four generations of military service. My grandfather was a first-generation immigrant from Italy who then fought for his new country across the sea in the Great War. When he returned, he and a buddy of his got one of the old airplanes from the Army Air Corps, one of the old biplanes. And if you ever saw the movie Out of Africa, you'll know the plane I'm talking about. I have a picture I can show you if you want to see it later. And they were barnstormers. And they took people on rides in an airplane for the very first time, and they let people see what the earth looked like from God's perspective. How about that? Then my grandfather got my father and both of his brothers, all three of them, into the Naval Academy down at Annapolis. And they went on to serve in Korea and Vietnam. Then my cousin Chip flew in the first Gulf War. My kid brother Blair served in Desert Storm. And here I am, the black sheep of the family, if you will, serving in the Lord's Army here in beautiful South Lancaster, Massachusetts. If you look at your bulletin, you'll see under the prayer requests that I now have three nephews in the Marines serving around the world, Stephen, Jonathan, and Joshua, three great biblical names for three great young men. I am going to see their parents later on this afternoon, their mom and dad. And let me encourage you that when I tell them and when my wife Betsy tells them that we are praying for their boys serving in the Marines around the world, it's serious business to them. They so much appreciate your thoughtfulness. You're remembering them. You're lifting them up in your prayers. We thank you for that. Now it's time for our offering for our college church budget that goes to help us serve, if you will, in the Lord's army here in our community, to serve our brothers and sisters in Christ, but those that are also among the periphery as well. Perhaps you've been blessed by some of those ministries. I am a direct result of the church budget and evangelism that goes on in all of its shapes and forms, and it goes to support ministries like what I've already referenced here and the beautiful music that we enjoy. At this time, I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward and receive our tithes and offerings. I invite you to rise as we sing. Let's give thanks and bow our heads. From Solomon's Song, my dove, my undefiled, is but one. She is the only one. She is the choice one. The daughter saw her and blessed her. Yes, the queens, they all praised her. Who is she that looks forth as the morning, fair as the moon, clear as the sun, and terrible as an army with banners? Dear Lord, we thank you that your banner over us is love. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
It is now time for the children's story and offering. The kids can come forward.
Thank you. Hello, boys and girls. How are you doing today? Who can tell me what I have here in my hand? Can you tell what it used to be? What do you think it used to be? What? A clothes hanger, you're right. But you know what else this is? Well, back when I was a kid, back before cars became so high-tech, this was how you opened your car if you locked yourself out of your car. How many people have done that with a clothes hanger? Yeah, see, look at all those hands, kids. It's a handy-dandy car opener. That's what this thing is. Now, I don't know why people always seem to have wire coat hangers around to open cars when you needed them, but they were around. And I have a story today about a woman who, she was at work, and she got a call that her child or baby wasn't feeling too well and needed some medicine to bring down its temperature. So she immediately left work, of course, as mothers would do, and she went to the pharmacy and she got some medicine so that her baby's temperature could come down. But you know what? She was in such a hurry that when she went in the store, she locked her keys in the car and she couldn't get back in. And she had her cell phone and she called the babysitter. She said, "I'm locked out of my car and I can't get into it." And the babysitter said, "We really need that medicine. You really need to hurry." And she said, "Well, I'm going to do my best." She said, "Do you have a wire coat hanger? You could get in there and try to get it." So somebody had a wire coat hanger and she was working on it and working on it, but it takes a little bit of practice and it's kind of difficult to do, and she couldn't do it. Finally, she just said, "I have got to pray about this." So she prayed. She said, "Lord, please help me to get into my car so that I can get to my baby and give him some medicine." And when you know it, there was a man walking by and he saw her trying to get into her car and he said, "Do you need any help?" She said, "Yes, I have to get into my car, I can't." And he took the coat hanger and in 2 seconds, he was in the car. And she said, "Oh, thank you so much. You're such a good person. God really used you, he sent you." He said, "Lady, I don't think you understand." He says, I'm not a very good person." He said, "I just got out of jail for stealing cars." And she said, "Lord, you sent me a professional." You know what, kids? God can use anybody. He can use car thieves. He can use young children. He can use babies. He can use anything and anyone, no matter who you are, to accomplish his purposes. You just have to be willing. So let's let Jesus use us, okay? Dear Jesus, thank you so much for being so powerful that it doesn't matter who we are, that you use us despite ourselves. In your name, amen. You can go to your seats.
Good morning, church. I would like to invite our dear family of this church, Alarcon family, to come here for a few minutes. We've been introducing to you different families of the church. We are trying to get to know each other better. So this time, I'm going to introduce to you the Alarcon family. I'm going to introduce Raul, the husband, and I'm going to ask him to introduce his wife.
This beautiful woman that's next to me, my wife, Maria, and we've been married next month. It's going to be 26 years.
Amen. And I also would like to ask you, I would like to ask you guys, how did you meet Jesus? Is the first question. And the other question is, how did you get to meet this family here, the college church? How did you come to the college church?
Okay, first of all, I met Jesus when I was little. My father was a pastor, and every day, I remember with my father and my mother, when my father was home, he was an evangelist, so he used to travel. But every morning and every afternoon, he had a very beautiful service, worship. And my mother used to read us, you know, those 10 books of Dr. Maxwell, the Bible stories. And the most beautiful and things I remember from when I was little. And I loved also going to church and listening to my father preaching. And that's when I met Jesus when I was little. I was born in the church.
Amen. Same as me. Yeah.
And, well, we came to the States in 1992. I didn't speak any English. And I came to AUC to study the ELI program. That's when I learned English and started coming to this church. But I went to different churches. We went to Northborough Church, and then we went to Worcester, and then Lancaster. And about 5 years, we started coming here, we're members here, about five years.
Amen. Okay, why don't we give them a hand and welcome back? Okay, thank you. Thank you. Now, I would like to invite those who wish to join us to the call of prayer to sing with me this song that we have in the bulletin. And please come if you have a special request or a praise thing. You're welcome to join us here at the front, and we're going to pray to the Lord. Thank you. Let's stand up. Let's kneel for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day. The sun is out. It's crispy, it's cold, and it's nice. And more than anything, we are here with you in this sanctuary. We would like to praise you for the freedom to worship you. We want to thank you for the Alarcon family and all the other families here represented. We remember also those families who are hurting in Nepal and other places in the world. Perhaps we have families here among us who need your comfort, who need your support and ours. Please be with them. Give them peace which surpasses all understanding. We also would like to present to you some health concerns. We remember the friends of our sister S.P. Lam and Jay, Elaine, Charles, Pete, and Benjamin. Oh Lord, this weekend we commemorate all men and women who have died in military service for this nation. We also remember Stephen, Joshua, Jonathan, and Kim, who are currently providing military service. Please send your blessings and protection upon them and their families. There are also some of your children that has come to the altar to present your concerns silently to you. We pause a moment for them to do that. We also would like to present to you the requests included in the foyer prayer book. And we'd like you to be with Tom, who will deliver your word this morning. Please help us to hear the message that you have for us through him. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
I want to wish everyone here a blessed Sabbath and everyone that's watching. I will read from the Bible, from Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. So you want to follow along? I'll wait a second. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle and over all the wild animals of the earth and over the creeping thing that creeps upon the earth."
And we are very grateful for Tom Murray to be here. Tom is our stewardship director. I asked him what he did. It took him a second to figure it out. He's the stewardship director for the conference. And he has a few hobbies, one of which apparently seems to be children, because he's got six of them, and between him and his wife. And so he's a man of a full quiver, is what they say in the Bible. And he also loves motorcycles, so we are going to invite him to come up here. We're thankful for him giving his time and talents. Thank you for being here.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. It's my pleasure to be worshiping with you this morning. I've been here since about 10 o'clock and was able to enjoy the Sabbath school this morning. And as I came in and I looked over the different options for Sabbath school, there were many great options. I wanted to go to every class. Everyone was already engaged in going in Sabbath school. I went to Julie's class, and we had Sabbath school on steroids in Julie's class. It was an active class, an engaging class. I needed a tutor. Other than that, we had a terrific experience. I would encourage anybody who is not getting the full blessing of coming and enjoying the Sabbath school experience, try it for the first time all over again, as they say. It was a wonderful blessing for me. Speaking of blessings, I got to pick the opening song this morning. And the opening song was, "The Lord in Zion Reigneth." And I love that song, but quite often we play and we sing that song as though it's a funeral march. But not here. Not here, and I appreciate the fact that we sang that song as though we believe the Lord in Zion reigneth. And it was a tremendous blessing to be here and to croak that out the way I do and listen to your melodious, outstanding voices and Chris John's talent. It was just a blessing. We're also blessed this morning to be worshiping with ladies and gentlemen who have served in our armed forces, and today we especially appreciate you and we lift you up in prayer. And I want to share with you a biblical blessing, because we do appreciate your service. If you're currently serving, if you have served, if there is someone in your family who has served, or even someone in your family who has been lost in service to this great nation, I want to read this biblical blessing to you this morning. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Pray with me one more time. Father, this morning we pray for the lady who is taken a fall, and we pray that you would guard over her. We thank you for sending your angels. Father, guard over her. Father, this morning, as we open your word, and we will do that here this morning, we ask for more love, more of God, less of me, for all of us. We ask in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Amen. He had the right stuff. He had all the right stuff. When the general was seeking the best and the brightest for a very important mission, a reconnaissance mission right into military enemy territory to assess the military readiness of the enemy, Chaffetz was chosen. You all remember Chaffetz. Chaffetz was chosen. One of the top guns. One of the few, the proud, one of the elite. Chaffetz was ready. Born ready. Like a prize fighter, he was chosen. And like a prize fighter, gloves up, shifting and shadow boxing and waiting for the opening bell, Chaffetz was fired up. He had been called. He had been activated. Chaffetz's life had been a journey, a rough childhood. He grew up not a child of privilege, but a child of abject poverty. Life was rough on the good days and desperate on the bad days until the general showed up. And when the general showed up, things got crazy. The Pharaoh went to his knees. A nation rose. The sea was blown aside before their eyes. The most powerful military on the planet was swallowed up in a moment. The daily meals were falling from the sky. A river of pure drinking water erupted out of a desert stone. Chaffetz had made it, one of the 12. The spy mission was amazing. The things that they saw were mind-boggling and amazing. A lot of what they saw was unnerving, as we discover in Scripture, Numbers 13 to be specific, an interesting read. A lot of what they found was somewhat unnerving. I want you to imagine with me for just a moment being one of the Israelites and waiting for the top guns, the 12, the best and the brightest, the few and the proud, to return from their mission, to return from their spy mission. I want you to imagine being one of those waiting to see what is the report, what is going to happen, where do we go from here, waiting for the reconnaissance team. Chaffetz was one of the ones that they were waiting for. He was one of the chosen, one of the leaders. He was the leader. He was chosen as the leader from the great tribe, not a minor tribe, the great tribe of Simeon. No doubt, Chaffetz was a rising star. Today we might call him a rock star of the tribe of Simeon. A household name. He was held in high esteem. Maybe he was quick-witted. Maybe he was brilliant with numbers. We don't know this. Maybe he was a ladies' man. We don't know his personality, but he was someone. He was a somebody. From what we read in Scripture, we can draw a few conclusions. He was a respected leader. He was analytical. He was cautious and measured. He was most likely well-spoken, influential, all likelihood not a couch potato. He was a man of action. The mission, as I said, was amazing. It was an eye-opener. We're told that 12 of them came back. 10 of them were very much shaken. Chaffetz was one of the 10. This book tells us that Chaffetz came back with a pretty compelling, very compelling, and unnerving report. Chaffetz, along with the others, told his story, some would say told his version of the truth. I want you to picture the scene with me for a minute as Japhet gives his story. One of the best and the brightest, very influential man, as he tells his story, as he stands and he stands before the people and the conversation ends and everyone just turns and focuses because Japhet is about to speak. He gets up, he straightens his cloak, and he begins to speak. "My brothers and sisters," he says, "people of the promise," because that was a crowd pleaser, "people of the promise, we have a proud history, and perhaps a bright future. We're actually becoming a nation, and maybe if we play our cards right, we may be a great nation someday. We're a subsistence economy. Actually, we're not quite a subsistence economy because the meals magically just show up for us. If it weren't for that, we would be somewhere below subsistence economy. Understand, please. We have no fortified bases from which to launch a military offensive. We have no industry. Our fighting men, bless their hearts, they're not ready for this. There are heavily armed giants in that land. When we stand close to them, we feel like bugs. They're giants. Their cities are massive, and they're fortified. The walls are impenetrable. Against these objectives, our boys would pretty much be target practice for the skilled archers who patrol the walls day and night. One more thing. The land swallows its inhabitants. We don't need this. We don't need this trouble now. 9 of the 12 spies stood by as Japhet gave his very analytical and very measured and very cautious and conservative report. So an amazing God-ordained opportunity. A God-ordained opportunity, we get them from time to time, a God-ordained opportunity was analyzed, measured, manipulated, second-guessed, and finally rejected. Conquest of the Promised Land was delayed for 40 years. Caleb and Joshua tore their garments in utter frustration. The Bible tells us that the Lord's anger burned. Japhet and his analytical, measured, cautious, careful, wide-eyed amigos died quietly in the desert and were forgotten. Did you hear what Marta read for us this morning from Genesis 1:26? It's early, early on in Scripture. Early on. In Scripture, God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, over all the earth." This is recorded by Moses under inspiration of the Holy Spirit. This is a reference to a conversation among the Holy Three on day six of our existence, day six of creation of our planet. Let us make mankind in our image, the image of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So what was it like in that conversation? In that conversation on day six? Did the Father start the conversation? Did God the Father start the conversation? Did he turn to the Holy Spirit? Did he turn to the Holy Spirit and start to say something? And what would he have said to the Holy Spirit? What would the Father say to the Holy Spirit? What would God say as he starts a conversation? He would say, Spirit. I guess he would say, Spirit, I love you. I love you. I love being with you. I love everything about you. I love what's going on this week. We are creating this week. I love you, Spirit. I'm just so excited. I'm so happy about what's happening here. It's been an amazing week so far. We have eagles, rivers, redwood trees, granite, sunshine. We've got warm breezes. We've got snow-capped mountains. We've got violets. Starfish, grizzly bears, and quite possibly raviolis. It's an amazing week, just an amazing week. As he turns to the Spirit, he says, today, it's going to be even better. Today, we're going to create the human family, the crowning act. We're going to create the human family. Today is going to thrill all of heaven. Today, we create the human family, Spirit, in your image. I want them to be like you. I want this human family to be like you. You inspire. You will inspire all of Scripture. You inspire. You comfort and you empower. I want to create mankind so that for each other they can inspire, they can comfort, and they can empower. Each other. They can be there for each other. Like you, Spirit. Imagine he turns to the Son of God. Imagine God the Father turns to God the Son. Can you imagine how it is when the Father turns and looks at his Son? Can you imagine his giant heart just pounding with excitement, saying, my son, what a week, my son, my beloved son. His smile is bigger than a mountain. My beloved son, you're a warrior. You're the warrior of heaven. You're a defender. You're a guide. You're the sustainer. You will confront evil. You are victorious. You're my son. I want them to be like you. Courageous, selfless, loyal, compassionate, honest. We already know that this world may not always be a perfect place, a perfect world. I want to give mankind the brave and sacrificial heart of a shepherd like you. Let us make mankind in such a way that he possesses skills and talents above all others, abilities to reason and to analyze, to discern and to plan, to build and to store and to share and to minister, to comfort. Let us make mankind so that he can provide and sympathize, empathize, forgive, encourage, protect, and worship. Mankind is going to be the crowning act of this creation. I wonder if in that conversation, I wonder if then the Spirit turns to the Father and says, Father, let us make mankind in your image. In your image, Father. The image of the Father. Compassionate, gracious, patient, abounding in love, filled with truth, forgiving and always just forgiving. Father, let's make mankind so that they know how to forgive like you. And I imagine the Son jumping in and, Father, you are love. You are the embodiment and the source and the explanation and the definition of love, of what love is. Can we make man, can we give them the immeasurable gift of love for each other? Through inspiration, we learn that man was originally endowed with noble powers and a well-balanced mind. He was perfect in his being and in harmony with God. His thoughts were pure and his aims holy. Through disobedience, his powers were perverted, and selfishness took the place of love. Selfishness took the place of love. God is love. God is love. Selfishness, so many times, supersedes and replaces God Himself. Have you ever been replaced? Have you ever been replaced? Do we love being replaced? Have you ever been replaced? Have you ever had the privilege of being replaced? It doesn't feel good. It hurts for a long time, and it certainly doesn't bring out the very best in us. God is amazing. We replace him all the time, yet he remains amazing. His love surpasses human understanding, and his love, we are told, endures all things, and it endures forever. Nothing can separate us from the love of God, not death, not demons, not principalities, nothing can separate us from his love. He hasn't given up on a single one of us. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope, plans to give you a future. Check this out from a book called God's Amazing Grace. The purpose and plan of grace existed from all eternity. Before the foundation of the world, it was according to the determined counsel of God that man should be created, endowed with power to do the divine will. That's being made in the image of God. The defection of man, with all its consequences, was not hidden from the omnipotent. It did not deter him from carrying out his eternal purpose, for the Lord would establish his throne in righteousness. God knows the end from the beginning. Therefore, redemption was not an afterthought. It was always an eternal purpose. God is not struggling to keep order. He's not struggling to keep things on track. God is fully in control. He watches, guides, and rules with unconditional love and perfect grace. Because of redemption, and through Jesus, the Redeemer, his plan for each and every one of us is on track. The plan is on track for each and every one of us because of the Redeemer. His aspirations for you are just as they were before the fall because of the Redeemer. His aspirations for you are big and fearless and wide open. They're wide open. Nothing can change the fact of your redemption. Nothing can change the fact of your forgiveness. Nothing can change Christ's desire to live in us and through us and to give us all abundance. He can pull us back from the smallness of humanity, of fallen humanity, and restore us through his Son back into the image in which we were created. This is the perfect, determined will and unchanging grace of God. Amazing grace. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like even me. I once was lost. Now I'm found and blind. But now I see. Today we celebrate that. Every Sabbath we celebrate redemption. All week long we get bombarded with the challenges and the opportunities, and some of them even unnerving opportunities, unnerving challenges all week long. Today we celebrate. The challenges keep coming all week, every day. The rent, the utilities, the repairs, the groceries, the tuitions, the finances, the church, the school, the college. Then you have Camp Winnipeg and evangelism and the mission trip and Compassion Boston and the World Church and ADRA and Asian Aid and 3ABN, and it goes on and on. Nepal, on and on it goes. For believers, for us in this room, there's no shortage of challenges, and there is certainly no shortage of opportunities for us in this place and in this room. Our response to these challenges, our response and our management of these challenges and opportunities is what we call stewardship. How we respond to challenges and opportunities. That's what stewardship is about. Those who respond in bold and unnerving and audacious faith are called Christian stewards. They're a brave lot who have determined to trust the Lord, to lay it out there, and to take the land. Giants and all, take the land. It's not for the faint-hearted. It never has been. Just like the days of Japheth and Caleb and Joshua, we're called to something larger than ourselves, larger than life. Praise God. We're called to something larger than ourselves and larger than life. Like Japheth and Caleb and Joshua, we are invited to trust the Lord, lay it out there, and take the land, take the promised land, giants and all. And the promised land for us is just outside these walls. That's our promised land. Our promised land is a college town in the middle of Massachusetts, a Seventh-day Adventist education community. That's our promised land. This community has an amazing and glorious past. And we pray for a kingdom-building and glorious future. This community has always, always, always been blessed with courageous men and women of God who have understood their calling, who've trusted the Lord without reservation, and who have stood courageously for the cause of Christ. Many of them are in this room. Like fortified cities, the powerful militaries, the giants in the land, the challenges that confront this congregation can be seen as unnerving. It can be unnerving. There are a lot of challenges. The wise King Solomon offered this timeless and sage advice to all of us. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own very limited understanding. In all your ways, in everything we do, acknowledge him, and he will guide our paths. Our God is an awesome God. His call is generous, it's loving, and it's unnerving from time to time. He's awesome. He's difficult for the timid. He's calling us to be what he made us to be. I'm going to go ahead and say, if you haven't experienced the thrill of full, unconditional, trusting partnership with God, I don't want you to miss out. If you haven't had full partnership with God, I don't want you to miss out. I spent many years missing out. I'm tired of it. I got tired of it a long time ago. If you're not in full partnership, I don't want you to miss out. I'm done living on the inside. I'm fed up with it. I'm done with it. I want us all to be done with it. Trust in the Lord. Lay it out there and take the land, giants and all. That's living Christianity wide open. You're made in the image. You're redeemed back into the image. So remember who you are. Remember whose you are. Because of your redemption, you, like the Spirit, can bring the inspiration. You can bring the encouragement. You can bring the empowerment. Because of your redemption, you, like the Savior, can bring the sacrifice. You can bring the tithes and offerings. You can bring the heart. You can bring the soul. You can bring the courage. You can bring the skin in the game. You can bring the victory. Because of your redemption, our redemption, my redemption, we, like the Father, can bring the patience, can bring the passion. We can bring the forgiving spirit. We can bring the grace. We can bring the love-born energy and purpose into this community. The Lord can and will do great things in this community. He's already shown it. He's already shown he can do and will do great things in this community. His mission, his gospel mission, will succeed. I want it to succeed with me. With me. It will succeed. His truth, as the song says, is marching on. I want to be in step. It may be with us. It may be with others. Who knows? Who knows? Perhaps you are being called to action right now in this community. You are being called to action as you have never been called before for such a time as this. Who knows? There are some big fish to fry. There are some big challenges. Be strong and courageous. Scripture counsels us, be strong and courageous. God has not given us a spirit of fear. That's not how we're created. That's not how we're redeemed. He has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. That's biblical truth. There's biblical power behind that. Wherever you set your foot, you will be on land that I have already delivered. No one will be able to stand against you for as long as you live. I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land that I promised. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions that you received from Moses. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. He opens floodgates. He opens the floodgates for us. He blesses beyond our ability to receive. Biblical fact. With God, all things are possible. We can take the land. We're created to take the land. We're redeemed and fitted to take this land. So remember who you are. Remember whose you are. Trust the Lord. Lay it out there. Take the land, giants and all. I want to thank Pastor Cook. I want to thank each and every one of you for the opportunity to come and share with you this morning and worship with you this morning. I wish you a very happy Sabbath and an outstanding and marvelous and joyful, family-centered, fun Memorial Day weekend. God bless. Father, we do know who we've believed. We commit our lives to you. We commit this week to you. We commit our thoughts and actions, desires to you, Father. As we go our separate way, Father, we pray that you would guide us, guard us, draw close to us. We ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Amen.